Oggi abbiamo con noi il professor Larry Randall Bray. Il professor Bray è docente di economia alla University of Missouri, Kansas City e senior scholar al Levy Economics Institute of Bar College di New York. Inoltre, Bray è stato studente di dottorato di Ayman Philip Minsky alla Washington University. I suoi principali campi di ricerca sono la critica della teoria e della politica monetaria ortodossa, le politiche di piena occupazione e l'instabilità finanziaria. Professor Bray, in molti hanno criticato la MMT sulla base della vostra identificazione tra Ministero del Tesoro e Banca Centrale, chiamando questo conglomerato settore governativo. Marc Lavoie, in un suo lavoro dal titolo The Monetarian Fiscal Nexus of Neocartalism, ha evidenziato questo aspetto come una critica benevola alla MMT. Anche Augusto Graziani, da poco scomparso, ha sempre tenuto distinti governo e banca centrale. Può spiegarci per quale motivo la MMT considera il Tesoro e la banca centrale come un soggetto unico? Professor Bray, several authors criticized the MMT identification of Treasury and Central Bank, a conglomerate denominated government sector. Marc Lavoie, in his recent work The Monetary and Fiscal Nexus of Neocartalism, pointed out this aspect in form of a friendly critic. Augusto Graziani, recently passed away, always distinguished between government and central bank. Could you kindly explain the reason MMT considers Treasury and Central Bank as a single unit?
Yeah. Well, there are a variety of ways to go about answering this question. One is, it doesn't make any difference. And this is something we've shown from the very beginning, that once you work through the balance sheets, you can do the balance sheets with all of the usual self-imposed constraints that many governments now operate under, such as the central bank cannot buy debt directly from the government, and second, the government can only make payments by writing a check on its account at the central bank. We show introducing these self-imposed constraints do not change the final balance sheets in any way whatsoever. We've also studied how the central bank and the treasury coordinate their operations, beginning with, I think the first paper was by Stephanie Bell, who is now Stephanie Kelton, around 2000, that demonstrated that they have developed operation procedures to ensure it makes no difference at all. So that's one way of answering it. It doesn't matter. The second way of answering it is that it simplifies the analysis so that it becomes easier to explain why it is that a sovereign government cannot run out of its own currency, which is the main point we're trying to make. And it's very simple to do this if we don't go into those very technical details of the operational procedures that central banks and treasuries now operate with. Because most people don't want to hear those things. In fact, most economists don't want to hear those things. So we simplify the analysis. And in our defense, everybody does this. We can show you that it's been a very common way to start an analysis with the consolidated government, which includes the government's bank, which is the central bank, and the government's treasury. There are two branches of government. In the United States, the central bank is a creature of Congress. It must do what Congress tells it to do. And for off and on, since the founding of our central bank, the Fed, in 1913, the central bank has, in effect, been just a department within the treasury. We had a famous fight in 1951 in which we got some separation of the two. But whenever there's been a crisis, whenever there's been a war, the central bank has been subjugated to the treasury to ensure that the government could spend as necessary to deal with the crisis or to deal with the war. Okay? So that's another way to go about answering it. And the third way is that these procedures that we now have that are common in the developed world are very unusual. If you go back through history, governments usually spent by directly issuing their own IOUs right out of the Treasury or the Exchequer. This is the way governments really did spend for the past 4,000 years, which is what Keynes said in the treaties. For the past 4,000 years, at least, money has been a state money, and the way that governments spent was by directly issuing their own IOUs in the form of either metallic coins or all over Europe in the form of wooden tally sticks or in the form of clay tablets in Babylonia. So historically, this is the most common way that governments have spent. And if you go around the world, it simply isn't true in many countries of the world today that the central bank is separate from the government in any sense whatsoever. The central bank is just part of the treasury. And the notion that the central bank can do something independently is completely foreign in many countries in the world. So those are three ways to go about answering that question. And finally, let me just say, Lavoie finally, after many years of criticizing us, comes to the conclusion that we're absolutely right. His main argument in that friendly critique was he doesn't think it's a good strategy. Okay, fine. If we've gotten down to arguing about what is the best strategy, let's try the different strategies and let's see which one works. Ours seems to be working to me. MMT now has literally thousands and thousands of followers. It seems to work.